Okay, so.
Καλησπέρα.
George, this is an English presentation.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Does Zoom support subtitles?
No.
Just kidding. Greetings, everyone.
Let me introduce you, George. He's a handsome young developer, as you can see, a Python enthusiast and an Angular addicted. He's currently working at Veturilo, and he likes a very good beer.
And this is Theofanis. He's a little younger and less handsome than me. He's a Python fanatic and a fan of Ruby and Elixir. He's also working at Veturilo and he appreciates a good beer like myself. This is why we are friends for ages. And fun fact, we went to work side by side. Just kidding again. The truth is that we met each other during the military service and we ended up working at the same company at Veturilo.
When we joined this company some years ago, our CEO asked us to create a fully operational IoT core for fleet management purposes. You know, car sending signals and the user is able to control his fleet. For those who don't know, IoT means Internet of Things. Device sends some data packets and to a server, and the server is able to provide to applications. At first, we thought that this was a small step for us and a great step for IoT.
But this was only the first impression. Back in reality, when we tried to design and implement our core, we come across several requirements, as we expected.
Of course, in our way to ensure our integrity, it was difficult then. About these requirements now. The first one was that we had to use a pluggable device in order to get all the signals from the car and send it to a server. The second one, of course, was to found an IoT core, a server basically, which can parse all this data and store the database. We conducted a fair amount of research and we found cheap and reliable solutions for devices, OPD devices, for us, with enough documentation to install a module inside the server. And of course, we also found cheap and reliable solutions for IoT cores with cloud servers. This wasn't so hard. We purchased a device, we implemented a module according to the given documentation, and we were able to parse all the incoming data packets to our server. Our main requirement now was to create a module that we, some services basically, which will be able to save all this data to our database. Of course, as Pythonists, we use Python for this purpose. Back then, we weren't as experienced as we are now, and we made a very simple Flask application, which can be easily found on the internet, according to many tutorials, so we will not share this code. Though we were afraid that we might fail back then, we tried and built this application. We named this module ingest because it receives data and delivers it to the database. It feeds the database basically. But if something went wrong back there, we may lose our data. This was the main problem now. In general, as you can see, the ingesting part for an IoT core is the same, no matter what language, no matter what techniques you like. A device sends a data packet to a device gateway, then the device gateway parses it as data, it sends it to an ingest module, to every ingest module, and then the data is saved to the database. This flow, looks good in an ideal world without error cases or bugs. Unfortunately, in the real life world where we live, programming projects are characterized from imperfections and flaws. For example, what we can do when a data packet fails to be saved in the database?
Here comes the meaty part. This question is answered by single sentence with many perceptions, ensuring data integrity. There are many definitions of data integrity.
Of course.
We think that it's important to create your own scope before your development. For us, data integrity comes with two basic principles. First of all, and most important, correct and not unintended storage. In other words, no corrupted data, no duplicated data, and everything saved in database. Second one, ensuring data quality. Look deep to your use case and check your database periodically for quality errors. With quality errors, we mean a correct value which comes with which doesn't make sense. For example, speed comes with a negative value. This, in the long run, will prevent you from bad user experience. We would like here to note another two important principles. This may be outside of the data integrity definition, but from our point of view, are equally important. First one, service integrity or working services. Take this one seriously. Just think, if a data packet is corrupted, you will lose only one data packet. If a service in a chain of services and modules is down, no data will be saved in your database. And second, devices integrity or working devices. You have to look for some important characteristics in order to choose your device, which will be integrated with your server. Please be careful in this one. Here, we think that it's important to tell you that for us, data integrity has nothing to do with data security on this level. We may disagree with us. Data security is equally important for us too, but it will take double and more time to include it in this presentation. It is also a step forward for the junior developers who want to be involved with IoTs.
So, here and back again, as Bilbo Baggins used to say.
Actually, this talk has a so ugly title that it could be combining Python with Blockbuster without any regrets.
Could be also IoT tips and tricks.
Yeah.
Before this small scope explanation, we're able to tell you about our first implementation for data integrity inside an IoT core, of course. Our first thoughts on how to deal with service downtime or corrupted data, temporarily save data to our file system, basically our failed events. This was the main code of our very, very first ingest module. You can see a while loop running, parsing some files which had inside failed signals from the car. We thought back then, yes, we've done it, that's a solution. But no, not at all. It wasn't a solution for us. We got some metrics and we had about 95 or 97% of CPU usage, quite a number. We even tried to put a sleep command here, but it didn't work. But we learned a lot back there. And I think as Master Yoda used to say, the greatest teacher failure is. And,
so after some research, we ended up combining new technologies with a Python program. First of all, we refactor a Python ingest with multi-threading. So now every data or signal run on its own thread and we have concurrency. Too many new words, let me explain. First of all, asynchronous. What is asynchronous? With asynchronous programming, we respond to requests outside of the main program execution. On a high level, this means that when a request comes to an instance or a module, it will be pushed in a message broker or something like that and will respond later. For us, it was very important to understand this term. We reduced our load and we had better performance because we could do heavy tasks later. Next term in this queue of new words is concurrency. You can see the first example here with no concurrency, that in order to start the second task, the first task has to be finished. Concurrency means what you can see on the second block. In a system with tasks running, the second task will not wait the first one to be completed, but it will be executed not necessarily at the exact same time. This means that the first task starts in its own thread and then a second thread starts the second task. And they nearly end at the same time. But what is a thread? On a high level and from our point of view, threads are units of a process which can run independently. Explain us further.
Of course, there are multiple ways to achieve concurrency indeed, and as a result, you will have better performance inside your IoT core. Here we included multi-threading and AsyncIO. As we already said, multi-threading requires multiple threads running different tasks and not necessarily at the same time. On the slide, we tried to represent, at least we tried, I think, yeah, George.
Sure.
We tried to represent the main difference between multi-threading and AsyncIO. As you can see on the first example, we have three tasks. They nearly end and start at the same time. On the other hand, we have AsyncIO. AsyncIO is about a single thread running some tasks. It can stop and resume the execution of each task according when it reaches an await command. So in the example here, we have task one, which starts, then its code reaches an await command, so it will stop, then task two will start, and task three, and this will continue until all tasks are finished. Now, on the other hand, for our interesting part, we wanted good performance. That basically our car signals comes and has to be saved as soon as possible. And here we used multi-threading for the first time. But could we do this with multiple processes and not multiple threads? Of course, after a specific point, this will be necessary for your system. You see, you may reserve more resources than needed if you use multiprocessing for the first time. Our advice here could be this: if you know what a single thread can do, then you will understand easily what multiple threads can do. And if you know what multiple threads can do, you will understand what a single process can do. Then it's easy to understand what multiprocessing is. Back on our code, as I said, we used back then multi-threading. We chose a thread pool executor in order to limit our open threads. That's exactly why we are added Max Workers 3, because we wanted to have a limit on open threads. After this, we had a simple socketing logic. We bind to a port. We are listening for incoming data. If this data comes, we have the ingest executor. We submit this data to the executor, and if it finds an empty thread, it will save it to the database. So here, maybe we could do a small recap, George. But first, I would like to tell you that threading without limit could be a little bit dangerous inside the system.
I agree, thanks. Sure, let's have a recap. Till here, we discussed about the ingesting part. In this part, a data packet comes from a device to device gateway. Then device gateway creates a socket connection and sends data to Python ingest. And then Python ingest try to save it in database. And of course, our solution for a concurrent and fast ingesting part was multi-threading with a thread pool executor. We also discussed about AsyncIO, but that's something that we will expand later. Also, we talked about the device integration part. There are multiple solutions with high or low cost according to your needs. We would like here to say that we have already prepared two GitHub repositories with all the code we are showing in these slides. The first one is about the Python ingest module, and the second is about IoT data integrity module. We have made it with a simple make file where you can install three containers, and then you can have a small IoT logic running inside your local PC. Now, after this important notes, back on our main thoughts. As we said back then, when we were junior developers, we were confused on how we can guarantee that all the signals, no matter what the service's condition is, will be stored in database. For this, we connected both the device gateway and Python ingest with a message broker. Our message broker is RabbitMQ, as you can see. But what is RabbitMQ? On a high level, and RabbitMQ stands as our middleman, which temporarily keeps our signals after a failed save attempt. And of course, it has two main actions, publish and consume. With RabbitMQ or other message brokers, you can build various solutions. But in our use case, it was this specific one. Now, about the publisher. So if a message has to be published to RabbitMQ, we have our publisher responsible for this task. As you can see on the slide, all these four steps, connection, channel, queue declaration, and publish are required for this process. Back on the code, we used Pika to connect with RabbitMQ. Pika is pretty reliable and has good documentation. Of course, you can choose other libraries to connect with RabbitMQ. Here, back on the code, we get the channel of the created connection and we try to declare a queue. Not that the queue maybe already exists. We would like this queue to be durable in order to remain there if RabbitMQ is restarted. Also, we would like the message to be persistent for the same reason. That's why we added delivery mode too. Finally, we send the message of our signal to the queue by using basic publish.
On the other hand, we have the consumer part. This consumer part is a part of a module that we will show to you later. In general, consumers are responsible to fetch all published messages in a RabbitMQ queue. Again, we have to create a connection. to get the channel of this connection. And of course, we're waiting to get all the incoming messages from RabbitMQ queue, because all the signals are coming as messages in this queue and in this consumer. So far we explained separate modules. Each of them has its own importance, but they are not combining a simple, very simple IoT core. We wanted here a module that will, or a service which will orchestrate, organize all these different services inside an IoT core, and will encapsulate also some tasks to ensure the previous principles. We used here AsyncIO for this purpose. You see, our interesting part has not so many failures, and we nearly had the thread waiting all the time for incoming messages. So we wanted to assign it some more tasks here to do. If you search around the internet for AsyncIO, you will find the term cooperative multitasking. That's exactly what I am trying to explain to you. We have an event loop running, as you can see in this slide. It gathers some tasks and it stops and resumes the execution of each task. AsyncIO is about an event loop running some tasks. This can be done to run multiple tasks concurrently through the use of a await command. Here in our code, we create an event loop called event loop. No imagination at all here. We set it up as our current loop, and we gather all tasks with the AsyncIO gather command. And of course, we run our loop with the run forever command. Of course, there are multiple ways and various solutions here to start a loop, but you will practice and you learn how to start your own loop. Now, the total flow of our simple, very beginning IoT core will be this. But believe me, this flow works. We have the organized module here. It awaits to consume some incoming messages from RabbitMQ queue. Then it pushes it back to the Python ingest. On its free time, it applies quality checks with periodic tasks to the database. It could do a lot of things, I think, here. It could monitor the server, many other things. But we would like to show you some of our ideas.
Before that ideas fans, I think that this flow actually looks better than ours. Our floor is not so beautiful shapes. Why?
I think, George, here the arrows are more green than before.
Yes, these here are a little bit darker.
We should talk to our team for color consistency.
Sure, I will complain.
So, about our ideas.
The first idea was to create periodic tasks. Think about a while loop running the task and stopping it for a specific timeout. As you can see on the top of our code, an infinite loop is running. Upon every iteration, it stops for a specific timeout. But how we can benefit from periodic tasks? So far, we only saw the first and most important principle of our scope, correct and not unintended storage. On every failure of the ingest part, a message broker take the signal. Now, with this example here, we check our data, basically our cache signals, for quality issues. Note that this data is already stored in the database. This will ensure the second principle of our scope, data quality. Imagine, for example, a broken device sending values for a longitude or latitude which are unexpected. It will be a serious user experience problem. As you can note on the code again, the wrong coordinates method checks for unacceptable values of coordinates. We may disagree here. Someone will say that we have to check for quality before save. We suggest not. Just think that checking for quality before save will reduce our ingesting patch performance. So we implemented smart and periodic checks after signal save. On organized module, you have the time to do these checks, but you have to be careful. You should avoid checking the same data again and again for quality issues. Another catch with quality checks is one of our additional principles, device integrity. If a device sends you wrong coordinates all the time, it has to be chained. So here you may want a mechanism to inform your user or your customer support department about this problem. So now, Till here, three of our four principles are shown: correct storage with message broker, data quality with quality checks, and also devices integrity with the same or even different checks.
Of course, George, and as you can guess, the last principle of our previous scope, service integrity or working services. I think here this could be done with various ways of programming, with multiple languages or anything you like. But here in our example, we wanted to show you all functionalities gathered inside the simple module. So we have a list of services, we bind to a port, if this port is already used and the service is up. I think it's not completed, but you will catch the meaning of this method. Again, we have a periodic usage here with a while loop and the AsyncIO sleep command with a given timeout. But here, George?
Here, I have a question, Fanis.
Of course.
Do we need so many modules?
Inside our flow, of course. If you want another step forward here, maybe a little bit outside of the junior, maybe a little bit outside of our junior days, you will see this flow. Actually, now our RabbitMQ is our middleman. It has three queues. Of course, our main queue, which parses all incoming data to the Python ingest. We have a dead letter queue where unacceptable messages are saved and will not push back to the ingest. And at least we have the failures queue where failed messages will push again to the ingest. Of course, here we have no organized module. It's been merged with the Python ingest, which can do both things, sends the events to be saved to the database, and of course apply some periodic checks. But here, George, do we need to code everything? Maybe we could use some ready solutions, some tools that will help us.
Sure, like Celery. Here, you could actually use plenty of solutions in order to save the time and resources. Celery could do this work for you, and we actually use it. But let me tell you this. It was very important for us to understand what is actually happening inside our IoT core. Don't be afraid to break it, just practice. First, you have to understand. We would like to wrap up this presentation and say that we did it to show that IoT is possible even if you don't have so much experience. Don't be afraid to be involved in such a project. The only thing we know, there is no perfect solution. So we would appreciate important feedback from more experienced developers on this subject. Nevertheless, we think it's very important for everyone to always look for better practice and solution. So this is it, Fanis. No more bad movie-inspired humor for our audience.
George, at least we tried, but some friends from Hollywood will have serious problem now. And of course, thank George Lucas for his movies. Before we say goodbye here, we'd like to thank some special people for us. Of course, our team of Petrillo developers for their limited support. Panos, George, and Thanasis for their important ideas. Those are colleagues from other companies. Bill, our system administrator. And of course, our rest of startup community for their daily support. Of course, here we have Harris. All the content is and the scripts before it's his. As we already said, we prepared two GitHub repositories with a very, very simple IoT logic. I think it's important to expand it, to clone it, to refactor it, and to know what could be done inside an IoT core. I think, George, when we first used Celery, we didn't even know what this tool can do. After some fair amount of debugging, then we realized what we could do with this task queue. So I think this is it. If there is any questions, we're ready to answer them.
Okay, thank you guys. So yeah, we have time for questions. So if anyone wants to ask,
don't be hard. Only the first presentation for us.
Yeah.
I hope you enjoy it.
So I have one question from Javier Martinez. He's asking, how do you do when you have to pass messages between coroutines?
we did this with the consumer part. Passing messages with the IO MQP module.
Okay.
It could be found on the second or the first GitHub repository. We have all the code gathered there.
Okay. Cool. Any other questions? I can also open the microphone if someone wants to ask.
Let me tell that we try to use multiple solutions here because we want to show you all possible ways to achieve concurrency or anything like this.
The idea is to help you think how you should think about the solution.
Yes, of course.
Okay. So one more question is, why Rabbit and not Kafka?
Of course, you can use Redis, you can use RabbitMQ, you can use Kafka. This according, we don't have real-time data, so we can use RabbitMQ. I think if we had the live tracking on our fleet management, this could be done with Kafka.
Okay. So I think that's the last one. So we have time if anyone wants to ask one more question. Okay. I think that was all. Congratulations. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for your questions.
Thank you.